Well, thank you. I'm really honored to be here. First, to hear the speakers this morning, I feel humbled to be on the same stage. What I'd like to talk with you about this morning is medicine, and I wonder if this, maybe I grabbed the wrong one, is medicine and public health. And before I do that, I'd like to define a word, really important word in my talk today, and that is a schism. A schism is a split or a division between strongly opposed sections or parties caused by differences in opinion or belief. And what would you think if I told you there's a schism between medicine and public health? And that this schism is not just a few years old, but more than a century old. And that it goes on in nearly every school and university across the country. And that everybody, pretty much everybody, working in medicine and public health knows about it, but we almost never talk about it. Well, it wasn't always there. In fact, medicine and public health were joined seamlessly in the 1800s when physicians like John Snow diagnosed a cholera epidemic using fundamental tools of epidemiology, when Robert Koch discovered infectious diseases through microbiology, and Edward Jenner experimented and discovered vaccines in the late 1800s. These were physicians, leaders at their time, who really worked with public health seamlessly in their communities. But something happened in the early 1900s. As medical schools were being developed across the country, there was concern that they weren't up to the standards expected of university programs. And so Abraham Flexner gathered experts together and published what is now a seminal report in medical education, the Flexner Report. And this report called upon medical schools to have a four-year curriculum, 2 years of basic science and 2 years of clinical science. And as a result, almost 200 medical schools around the country either closed or were merged to bring the quality of medical student education up to snuff. But what it did was jam-pack the medical school curriculum so there was little or no room for the public health sciences, things like environmental science or psychology or sociology. And so, sensing that the doors to the medical school were closing, experts began to meet across the country to talk about how to educate people in public health, since that opportunity didn't appear to exist in medical schools. And in 1915, the now famous Welch-Rose Report was published and talked about how schools and universities should develop standalone, independent schools of public health on campuses not affiliated with medical schools. And in fact, William Welch, the author of this report, became the first dean of the first School of Hygiene and Public Health at Johns Hopkins University. And over the next 50 years, schools of medicine and schools of public health were established on nearly every campus across the nation. But these schools of medicine and public health, these schools of medicine and public health, I'm going to animate that. It took me a long time to do that animation, so I need to thank you. And I figured that out by myself. I'm proud of that. Schools of medicine and public health really grew apart during the ensuing 50 years, so that deans not only worked in parallel, but often competed for the scarce resources that are available on campuses. When I was growing up, I had no idea what public health is. I wanted to be a doctor. I went to medical school here. This is the old medical school where I began my medical school training. And as seen with the gentleman with his head in the books, I memorized my way through the first 2 years of basic science. And I enjoyed nearly every clinical rotation that I had during the clinical years. Well, maybe not surgery. It wasn't my strongest suit. But then when I graduated and started my internship as a practicing physician, I saw patients who were really sick kids at Children's Hospital at the University of Washington in Seattle, or adults at Virginia Mason Hospital. And while caring for these patients, my mind began to wander. I thought, why did this child have to be here in this situation? In the ICU, a result of a car accident when he wasn't wearing a seatbelt? Or why does this individual have to be in the ICU after a lifetime of smoking, when we know the harms of smoking and the risk of developing cancer or heart disease? And in fact, why did he have to spend the last few days of his life hooked up to a ventilator when it would have been better for him to spend those last few days and hours with his family at home? I found the answers to these questions in a textbook, Harrison's Textbook of Medicine, with the heading Epidemiology. I was intrigued to learn that we not only knew the causes of most of the problems I was seeing in the hospital, but we also had evidence-based strategies to prevent them. And yet, almost never did we talk about epidemiology and prevention in the clinical setting. We had to take care of very sick patients. So I personally took a little detour in my training, and I went to the Centers for Disease Control. I joined a two-year training program called the Epidemic Intelligence Service. It's boots on the ground, grassroots epidemiology, diagnosing problems in communities. I then took advantage of a preventive medicine residency where I specialized in preventive medicine, and even did my Master of Public Health degree on a career development program at the CDC. And at the end of 6 years, I felt fully trained in public health, but I realized that I had officially left medicine behind and joined the public health profession. Well, I had the good opportunity to come back to Madison to actually practice preventive medicine at the Wisconsin Department of Health Services. You can see my office in the state office building there, second to the right, down on the third floor. In a cubicle, actually, not my office. And I spent 10 years not seeing patients individually, but working with communities, thinking about how we could improve air quality in restaurants by banning smoking, how we could reduce youth smoking by increasing the cigarette excise tax, how we could help women survive breast cancer by promoting mammography, or even learn more about firearm injuries by developing a surveillance system for firearm injuries. And so at the end of those 10 years, I had learned about the practice of public health, and I also had the opportunity to work with medical students who would come up during their fourth year of medical school, and they would work on a project with me. And I was struck that this was the first exposure in their medical school training that they had to public health and epidemiology. So when the opportunity arose to come back to the medical school, I jumped at it. And I joined the faculty of the Department of Preventive Medicine. And the first thing I did was develop a public health elective. I called it Physicians in Public Health. And this elective was one credit, optional elective. We met in the evenings after classes were over, and we talked about public health issues. That was my plan. Unfortunately, only a couple of students signed up. So I reposted the description of what this elective would be like. It was still talking about physicians and public health, but I offered free pizza. And 20 or 25 students came to the elective. I brought in my colleagues from the health department who were leaders in environmental health, infectious disease, maternal and child health, epidemiologic researchers, all physicians, all working in public health. And the medical school students listened intently, but I actually think they came for the pizza. Until one day, a colleague came in. A colleague came in who was a family medicine doctor. She had a busy clinical practice, but she also worked in the community, in an underserved community. She also worked overseas in Uganda, working on better sanitation to improve health in a developing country. And as she told her story about doing medicine and public health, the students were captivated. They listened intently long after the pizza was gone. They met with her after the lecture and asked if she could work with them and maybe they could shadow her in her clinical work or in her public health work. She said that the public health experiences that she had made her a better doctor, and the clinical experiences that she had made her better at practicing public health. So I had what I call my public health and medicine epiphany that night. And I decided the next year to change the name of the course and how we structured the course. I now called it Physicians in Medicine and Public Health. And the result was amazing. Over 100 students signed up the first year for this course, first and second year medical students. And I invited busy clinicians to come to tell their story. A surgeon who ran the trauma unit at UW Health, but also developed global guidelines on disaster preparedness. A pediatrician who saw kids in his office during the day, but nights and weekends developed a program called Reach Out and Read, where kids are provided books in the doctor's office to improve child literacy. An internist who saw very complex medical cases, but she was also the president of the Wisconsin Medical Society. And students were amazed that people could be both clinicians, outstanding clinicians, and public health doctors. So over the next 20 years, the School of Medicine transformed its educational curriculum to not only have courses on basic science, biology, and clinical science, but also public health. And in fact, about 15 years ago, we changed the name of the medical school. It is now the School of Medicine and Public Health. It's a medical school that embraces public health not only in its mission, but in its name. We also transformed the curriculum for medical students. We offer to all medical students, I should say, we require of all medical students that they take courses in public health and primary care throughout their 4 years. We've woven the curriculum for all medical students. We had a medical student come and he complained that he thought there was too much public health education, and we said you should have looked at the name of the school and you should have read the web page before coming and not be surprised about this. We also developed a tier of public health called the Public Health Path of Distinction for students, some students who want to do more. For example, take the elective that I offer, or do a project in a community involving public health. And then finally, the third tier is for those students who want to be fully trained in public health and get a Master of Public Health degree. We call that the MD-MPH dual degree program. So we've significantly changed the curriculum. But the cold, dark reality is that the schism between medicine and public health is real and pervasive. Medicine continues to focus on diagnose and treatment, often in a for-profit setting where the incentives are for more care with rising costs. Public health, on the other hand, is focused on prevention in a nonprofit setting where a goal is better health, and yet we have crumbling infrastructure, no more apparent today as we confront a potential coronavirus pandemic. So this schism is a challenge for us in moving forward. And I'd like to tell a story that I heard from a physician, a busy emergency room physician who was seeing kids in New York City who were coming in with asthma exacerbation. And he did a further study and he found out that they're coming from homes that weren't as clean as they could be, that had a lot of allergen from mites and cockroaches. So he simply prescribed vacuum cleaners. And after vacuum cleaners were provided, once the people had the opportunity to clean the home, 30% reduction in emergency visits due to asthma exacerbations. And he published this story, presented it, and it was great news. Except one day he was visited by the chief financial officer of the hospital, who said that they had a significant problem, that the revenue generated by seeing these kids in the emergency room was now missing, and this hospital was at risk of not staying open. They depended on kids having asthma and the revenue generated from that exacerbation and having to come for care. Clearly a schism between medicine and public health. And it's no more apparent today than in the everyday practice of clinical medicine. Imagine a primary care physician talking with a patient who's struggling with obesity. What does she have to offer? Brief advice, maybe a pill for diabetes management. If it gets really serious, refer to a surgeon for gastric bypass surgery. But when that patient leaves the office, they are confronted by Western society constructs, things like how much time we spend in a car, television, fast food, our workplace, which is focused on the laptop now. We have a sedentary society. Even now there's a term called obesogenic lifestyles. So despite wanting to solve this problem, physicians are stressed with confronting them in the clinical setting and not being able to do anything about the community setting. So clearly, we need to bring back medicine in public health. This schism has been present for over a century. It won't go away overnight. But I think with the current physicians in training and future physicians, that we have an opportunity to be optimistic. Young people today see that we need to redesign the healthcare system, from one that is incentivized to provide more care to more people to one that is rewarded for improving health in communities. We have that opportunity, but it's going to be a challenge. Medicine has the money, but public health has the mission. Imagine what we could do if we brought the money of medicine together with the mission of public health. And I'd like to end with a quote. It comes from Bobby Kennedy, and I've modified it a bit. Some people see things as they are and ask why, but I think of things that once were and ask why not again? Why not medicine and public health? Thank you.